I think the president of the African Development Bank already introduced most of what I'm going to say. And Kapil, also our vice president before he left, also alluded to the Feed Africa. So I'll just go to the essentials that maybe have not been discussed. And then this will give us opportunity to interact, to see how we can leverage Brazil's experience for African continent, and how we can use some of the things that we have achieved the last 50 years and leapfrog. As one of my colleagues said, we don't have 50 years, but in the next 10 years, if we can get there. So in three areas, why transformation, and what is the response of the African Development Bank? And then I will take you through some of the flagships, some of the initiatives that we are developing for which we are seeking co-development and co-support. And then I will talk briefly on potential areas which we can also agree to work with our Brazilian counterparts. This slide tries to encapsulate most of what has been said. The fact that poverty is very high in Africa, about 49% of Africans live below poverty line of $1.25 a day. In aggregate, this is about 420 million. And as the Kapil was saying, in 10 years, if you don't do anything about it, if we just remain at the level we are, this number will rise to 550 million in the next 10 years. And the fact that 33% of African children are malnourished, and in terms of number, over 50 million, actually 59 million children below the age of 5 are stunted as a result of not having enough to eat. And the fact that because we don't produce enough, we tend to import a lot of what we should be producing, what we should have, what we have the comparative advantage to produce, and we import this. So these are some of the concerns. And finally, the fact, I think Kapil also mentioned it, using illustration with cocoa, that we also have little value addition, even for those that we export. We don't do a lot of value addition, and we need to change the scenario. So for us at the African Development Bank, this had led to about four objectives of what we want to do. The first is how we can contribute to end extreme poverty by 2025. And for us, we want to free about 130 million people from extreme poverty in the next 10 years. And secondly, how we can eliminate completely hunger and malnutrition in Africa in the next 10 years. This is the ambition we set for ourselves. And how we can, you saw the figure there, as of today, we're importing about $35.4 billion annually of food. And as we said, if by 10 years we continue at this level, this is going to rise to 110 billion. We don't have that money, so we should not kid ourselves that we should be able to feed ourselves in 10 years if we cannot start to do something today. So our effort is to eliminate this import, this level of import, by making sure that, like Brazil, Africa should be able to produce enough to feed itself. And then to take, to add some value, to take Africa to the top of the commodity value chain. I think Kapil mentioned this slide, so I will be brief about it, especially the one on the bottom left, which shows that for most cases, we are less than 25% of the best practices. Our productivity is so low that unless we raise the productivity, then all we are saying will not happen. And the fact that because of this, you see the gap between import and export, and this is what we need to reduce. And also, the impact of urbanization, as people move from rural areas to urban areas, this is also added to the demand for food. And finally, the increasing middle-income class and the change in preferences. As incomes improve, people tend to shift from standard food to premium food. So this is also putting pressure on Africa, and we need to respond to some of these changes. What we are saying here is that we are not just at standstill. I think there are pockets of transformation going on, but it's not going at the level that we expect. In Kenya, for example, the horticulture industry is doing very well. In Ethiopia, the floriculture is doing very well. Nigeria has demonstrated how through efficient input distribution system and farmer registration system, they've also been able to expand in productivity and farmers' production. So there are pockets of transformation going on, but it's not widespread. So our effort is to see if we can replicate this across Africa. So what we have done is to look at those 18 commodity value chains which Kapil mentioned, for which Africa is spending a lot of money to import. And we ask ourselves that if we can target this, then we will be addressing the four cardinal issues that we started with. So these are spread across Africa, as you can see from the map, and not only in countries, but also in various, in some ecological zones. We are already aware what you have done with the Cerrado here, and we can leverage this experience and also look at Africa's savanna and the Sahel and bring this type of success to Africa. So this is one of the ambitions that we've set for ourselves. To do this, we looked at what we call enablers. What are the key elements that we need to focus on in order to address this? And there are about seven of them. I'll run through them quickly. And they're addressing some of the problems that I mentioned earlier. The first one is increased productivity. So here we're looking at technology. I think my colleague from FARA mentioned the work we are doing with the CGI centers, where we're trying to bring technologies that are lying on the shelf and get them to the farmers, working with the various countries. So we have a program called Technologies for African Agricultural Transformation, TAT. It's about $850 million, which we are working with our partners, and the bank is probably going to approve this early next year, and we will see how we can work with the various CGI centers in Africa, most of them are listed there, to take these technologies. Also, the issue of inputs, which I referred to earlier, successes have been achieved in countries like Nigeria, in Rwanda, and we want to expand this. The issue of mechanization, which is very key as part of technology also, to ensure that agriculture, as my president said, is business, and not carrying hoes and machetes and going to the farms, and that is not the way we can transform. The issue of agro dealers, making sure they expand the business of input supply, and also quickly, the second part is the issue of value addition, which I referred to earlier. The issue of post-harvest losses, about 30% of even what we produce is lost. This is not sustainable. So we are putting up programs that can address some of these. We are setting up agro processing facilities across the continent, developing the corridors through which some of these commodities pass so that we can reduce and then we can also scale up markets. The third area is the infrastructure deficit, both hard and soft infrastructure. Looking at roads, looking at power, looking at water, the bank would double its support to African countries to make sure that we address some of these areas. And also, also looking at soft infrastructure, ICT is very key. I believe there's a lot we can learn from Brazil in the ICT world. The third area is finance. Without finance, I don't think we can really do much. I think this is an area we'll come back to later. The level of financing of agriculture is very poor, and we need to set up a number of innovative financing instruments that can leverage resources. There's a lot of liquidity actually in Africa, but most of this is not going to agriculture. So what can we do to ensure that most of this finance is brought into agriculture? So this is one area we are looking at. The business environment, how can we work with government to look at some of the critical areas of policies in tax reforms, in price systems, in land issues, and so on and so forth, so that we can create the type of environment that will bring partners from all over the world to come to Africa and invest, and also African farmers themselves, and including young people and women, to also have opportunity to go into agriculture. The issue of, I've already started talking about women and youth, the issue of inclusivity. How do we bring young people into agriculture? How do we bring women? How do we look at the issue of nutrition? I talked about malnourishment and stunting. What programs do we have? So the bank is looking at all this comprehensively and setting up some programs that will address some of these issues. And then finally, coordination. If we don't put our efforts together, if we don't coordinate, then we'll duplicate efforts and resources. So we are putting up a number of programs, including bringing ministers of agriculture and ministers of finance annually to talk to each other and be able to agree on how we can support. So these are the seven critical areas that we think that if we put our efforts and resources working with African governments and working with our partners, we will be able to achieve some transformation in agriculture in the next 10 years. So in order to do this, we've developed a number of what we call flagships around some of the areas that I talked about. The first one is the one I refer to as Technologies for African Agricultural Transformation, TAT, where we are working with a number of CGI centers and other research institutions, including FARA in Africa, to make sure that those technologies that they've developed but are not getting to the farmers, we can facilitate, we can provide the vehicle through which this can reach the farmers. So IATA, the International Institute of Tropical Agriculture in Ibadan, is leading this effort. They are going to set up a clearinghouse where these technologies will be screened to make sure that they've been tested and that they are what farmers need, and we can provide them the resources to be able to take them to scale in these in the countries where they are needed. I think there is some glitch with the. The issue of youths, Kapil mentioned here how the African Development Bank is trying to create a number of jobs for young people, some of them who are leaving the continent looking for greener pastures elsewhere, whereas opportunities abound in Africa, especially in agriculture. So one of the programs that we are supporting in agriculture is to take young graduates, most of them who don't have jobs, and try to train them, give them some level of training in how to run businesses in agriculture, in what we call incubation centers. I think the president of the African Development Bank mentioned it, so that most of these youths, we can provide them financing through innovative financing mechanisms to be able to go into agriculture. As he himself has said, 31 countries have signed on to this program. About five of them will approve resources for them this year, and probably in the next year another 20 or so will also join this program. So this is a very important program for young people. It's very exciting, and most countries are coming to ask us to support. I believe the honorable ministers who are here will talk about themselves because most of them have are quite aware of this. This for us will create about 105 million jobs in the next 5 years across the continent, and is something that our president is very much excited about, and we are working very hard on this. Another program that we are trying to help to set up is an innovative financing mechanism. Commercial banks are not lending to agriculture because of what they call passive risk. They think agriculture is very risky. They don't want to put their money there. They think that young people don't have experience. They cannot put their money. So we are trying to de-risk the commodity value chains. And we're trying to give comfort to these commercial banks that if they lend to agriculture, and if there is a loss, they will buy back this loss. So we are setting up these facilities through which they will have comfort. And we believe that with these young people, women, and farmers, in the various commodity value chains can have access to agricultural finance. One other area we are looking at is, we know that question of input mechanization is very key, but not many farmers can afford to have their own individual machines. So we are looking at an option of equipment hiring services where we can also support people who can buy this equipment and then lend them to farmers at a cost and provide them the services. Of course, where cooperatives are able to buy the equipment themselves, we also encourage them to do so. But this one area, the one option that we are looking at, supporting people, young people in particular, who want to run this business, give them the resources, they can buy the equipment and hire services to farmers. We also have a flagship on farm and post harvest waste and loss, so that we can stop. You can see the graph on the ground on the bottom of that, where losses range from 21% for cereals to over 60% for vegetables. This is not sustainable. So we are putting up a program that can address post harvest losses. And of course, the issue of nutrition, we're also putting up a program that would integrate nutrition into the food systems to make sure that we have some sort of fortified food, and working with our partners, we can reduce the issue of stunting and malnutrition. We are also aware that this will cost money. Our estimate is that we need about $30 billion annually to be able to achieve full transformation across those value chain, but of course it will generate sufficient benefits. Our estimate is that if we're able to invest $30 billion annually, we'll be able to generate $85 billion also annually. But first we have to invest. Today, we don't have those resources. Our estimate is that we're able to, our total investment in African agriculture is about $7 billion. So we have about $23 billion per annum gap. African Development Bank is trying to, as the president said, we want to invest $2.4 billion annually, and then we expect that our partners will also invest. But most particularly, we will call the governments, African governments. There is what we call Maputo Declaration, where they are supposed to put 10% of their annual budget into agriculture. But I estimate that today, on the average, they are putting just about 3%. So if they can get even to 5%, and then if we can de-risk commercial banks to also lend to agriculture, and if we can also set up instruments to leverage resources from pension funds and sovereign wealth funds that are sitting there but are not getting to agriculture, we believe that we can find enough resources to support African agricultural transformation. So these are some of the areas and the type of investment that we have in the various parts of Africa, with West Africa and East Africa receiving a greater proportion of this. So which areas do we think that we can collaborate with Brazil? Here, I'll quickly run through them. Research, I mentioned research, with working with Embrapa and others to see how we can support research, how we can support technology, getting technology to the ground. The issue of the equipment hiring services and mechanization is one area that we feel your experience will be of help to us. Infrastructure and private sector co-financing. I think my colleague, Madam Diallo, will talk about private sector and industrialization later, but these are areas that we want Brazilian companies to come and talk to us so that we can also take them to the countries where most of our programs will be implemented. Innovative financing that we have mentioned. If you have experience how to set up this, we'll be happy to listen to you and see how you can help us. The issue of youth entrepreneurship, if you have experiences that you can share with us, we are aware that a lot of African youths are coming to Brazil. We want to know the type of training they get and how they can come back to the continent and support what we are doing with the youth program. The issue of nutrition and fight against hunger. These are some of the areas. There was one slide that actually jumped, what we call agropole or agro-industrial parks, where we're supporting integrated agricultural business models in a number of countries. Nigeria is here, DRC, Senegal, Cote d'Ivoire, and quite a number of countries are doing this. And we believe developers from Brazil can also come to Africa to support us. Here I have a number of what we call high ticket programs in Ethiopia, in Algeria, Uganda, DRC, Gabon, Nigeria, Morocco, Cote d'Ivoire, and quite a number of countries. You will get this slide, and if you are interested in any of these operations that we are doing in most of these countries, and you think that you can provide any form of service or be part of the contractors or be part of co-developers, you talk to us and we'll be able to see how we can work together and collaborate in these countries. I stop here. Thank you very much.